Thanks. We're all comfortable where we are. We don't want to move up, move in. Okay. Okay, that's all good. Thanks for having me here. Who's from, anyone from Ypsilanti originally? Native Ypsilantians, awesome. Anyone from St. Louis, Missouri? Okay, well, you know, I always have to check. I lecture at U of M a lot, and you know, a lot of them are from lots of different places, but I haven't found a St. Louis, Missourian lately. So I'm gonna give you a little overview of Growing Hope. If someone could give me, there's not a good clock in here. Oh, there's a clock on my computer. Okay, I'll just look at my computer's clock. I was gonna ask for someone to give me a time check. I speak quickly, can you follow me? Yeah, most people usually can. I'll pack a lot of words in the next hour. And I'm going to tell you mostly about our organization, about where we're coming from, about what we're doing, how we feel like we're making an impact in the community, and really about how our values as an organization drive the work that we do. As I mentioned, we're a nonprofit in the community. I'll tell you a little more about what we do. But first, I'm going to define food system, because I like to do a little education about the context that we're working within. People heard kind of food system, local food system, that terminology before. So a local food system is thinking about food from where it comes from to where it ends up and all the things in between. These are some examples sort of along what we call the food system chart or flow chart or whatever that might be that are maybe non-traditional. Production, where we're growing something or raising something in the terms of animals. But also in urban settings, we might think about urban farms. Anyone know what aquaculture is or aquaponics? Who's heard that? What is that? Not hydroponics, that's a little different. Aquaponics, what's aquaponics?
Animals in the water.
So growing animals in the water, really cool trend lately in urban areas, actually, is in people's hoop houses or greenhouses that you'll see pictures of later. People are growing fish in like swimming pools and feeding them with worm poop, basically, as a closed-loop organic system, and selling tilapia fish to high-end restaurants, and really, really, really cool systems. Orchards and ways we're having producing fruit. Processing, bakeries, canneries, food processors, sort of overall. Food business incubators. We have one that's being developed right now in Ipsy, where we're going to have a shared-use commercial kitchen. So people who need to prepare food in a licensed kitchen to be able to sell it to the public, basically, will have a space to come, because it's a big limiting factor that we find. Community kitchens, another version of that. Distribution, so how our food gets from where it's grown and or put together, like processed, to where we are. So that's a whole lot of systems of trucking, largely in our country, but also flying and shipping and things like that. Some of the distribution systems that we think about in a local food system are mobile food trucks. Anyone ever heard of a mobile grocery store? There's a really neat one I recently read about in Chicago that's an old Chicago city bus that they have retrofitted to be, I think that one is called Fresh Moves, that they've retrofitted to be like a grocery store on wheels. So in places, and we'll get into more into this about food access, where people don't have access to fresh and healthy food as readily, this truck may, or this bus, literally, which is all painted, all cool, makes the rounds. And you walk in, and instead of, you know, the seats being there, it's a giant fresh food grocery aisle. So mobile food trucks are one of the new innovative things going on in our world. And other distributors focusing on local food. Because our food supply comes from far, far, far away. Largely. There's figures, and this is the wrong figure because I don't remember it, and I should have looked it up again. But the average meal travel, like your average plate of food travels something like 1,200 miles, like some crazy amount of food, of distance, because the ingredients are coming from all over the world. Then they're being flown or driven or trucked or whatever to all over the world, and then moved again to all the world, and then to this just central distribution center, and then to the grocery store, and then to the this and this and this and this. There's a lot of transportation, a lot of energy, also a lot of freshness, also a lot of loss of quality, etc., that our food moves around so much. So when we're thinking about a local food system, where our goal is to how much of this and how can we do all of these steps in one locality, thinking about locally distributors who are distributing maybe on a smaller scale than these big peoples who may supply your dorms currently, or if you're in a dorm cafeteria, right, you maybe see the Cisco big trucks kind of pull up. So let's think about on often smaller scales. Retail, restaurants, groceries, of course, smaller food stores, food carts as a growing trend. Farmers markets we'll get into. And then eating, and the things that go around eating and where we're eating and the education we're doing. And then thinking about waste management, composting. We're talking to a really neat startup company right now coming out of U of M's Business School and School of Engineering called Regenerate, who is developing an anaerobic digester that we may actually pilot at our place. Anyone know what an anaerobic digester does? I know. I didn't really either. I knew those words, but not what that really means. So they're generally these like ginormous things. Like I imagine the size of this room or a lot bigger from the pictures I've seen on Wikipedia, that you're putting stuff in and through an anaerobic process, so without oxygen, are breaking stuff down. So not composting, because composting is an aerobic process where we're using air to make stuff into nice soil. But anyway, you're breaking stuff down. So they are working on this cool product where in a smaller space, like this kind of size space, a grocery store or a box store or a university cafeteria kind of thing can put in 500 to 1,000 pounds of food waste, including meat and bones and things like that, paper products, every day. And it actually does its magic in there. And then once a month only, this unit needs to be emptied. And it like a big truck comes and sucks out kind of like a sludge, but it's basically a kind of semi-composted liquid material, which is a really kind of neat waste reduction system that then gets more fully composted, so added to piles and farms with other compost and becomes this really cool green product. And then the product that comes off of that also is energy. So usually in the form of methane gas, but they're capturing the energy and using it for radiant heating. So you put stuff in, it breaks down, you get the benefits of not having other waste, not having the smelly waste, because it all happens in an enclosed system, and then you get heat out. So we're talking about some creative ideas, like could we heat a hoop house, a greenhouse, with sort of radiant heating by going around and collecting food scraps from local businesses, local small restaurants and things like that, and feeding them into this, and then we have free energy. So cool stuff like that in the waste part of things. So as we're thinking about local food system, how do we bring this all into one locality, one region, you might say, one food shed is a word that we use. What are the benefits of having a more localized food system? What?
Fresher
food.
Less energy.
More nutrition.
Local economy.
Local economy. That's what I was waiting to get to move in, move the into the slide. Our mission as an organization, as was mentioned, is to help people improve their lives and communities through gardening and healthy food access. Now, something about our mission and the way our mission statement is written is our mission is not, note, to improve people's lives and communities through gardening and healthy food access. It's specifically to help people improve there. And that gets at one of the core values of Growing Hope, in that we are helping people do for themselves. We're helping people become more self-reliant. We care particularly about people who have less access to resources, whether that resource is money or transportation or they speak the native language in a community, et cetera. But we want to make these opportunities available for everyone in our community, and we feel like doing that in affordable, accessible ways makes folks in our community who have the least access to resources the strongest. Gardening was our mission statement used to end at that word gardening, and then we started a little thing that became a really big thing called the Downtown Ypsilanti Farmers Market. Who's been there before? I was like, I know you've been there. The Downtown Ipsy Farmers Market, which I know you guys will all go to May through October, Tuesdays, 2 to 6 p.m., right downtown Ipsy. Not scary at all. Really great down there, right next to the post office. So we needed to add some things that we were doing. We started to get into more work that was around healthy food that was not specifically about the growing part of it. And I'll get to a little more about the garden. And why do we think this stuff is good? Is that really... Food is a basic human right, and that we think that everyone in our community should have access to healthy food. And that is just sort of a core belief. And think that also that gardens and food are just such great things to bring people together, and that there are very few things in our society that where we're not really divided by class, income level, by race, by neighborhood, by so many things. Food is something we all share. Who here eats? Right? Right? Okay, so who here likes to eat? Right? Who here likes healthy food-ish? Okay, we're going to get there. It's okay. Sophomore in college, you're going to get there. And that it's something that every culture has a food tradition. Everyone comes, families have food traditions. It's something that we can really cross those lines of class and race and culture and mobility and formal education that so often stratify us in the way that the person with the PhD is the one who is most respected or most revered or seen as having the most knowledge or the most power, and the person with the least is on the opposite end of the spectrum. But the best cook is not necessarily the person with the PhD. And the best gardener, likewise, is not necessarily the person with the PhD or the person who's been in the community the longest or the person with the highest income. That those sort of learning and the sharing really crosses all those bounds from food and cooking overall, but also gardening, because it's something that people have done since the dawn of sedentary agriculture, is put seeds in the ground and help them grow and grow food and grow culture and grow economies from there. So some of the reasons we think we kind of categorize some of the benefits in health and nutrition. So nutrition, kind of an obvious one when we're talking about healthy food, but we think about the other physical activity benefits of growing. So gardening is second only to weightlifting as best ways for women to build bone mass. And gardening is equivalent to moderate walking, according to the Centers for Disease Control. So you know all those messages in our society, the let's move from the Obama, Michelle Obama, of like, let's just get out and move, and that's one of the key ways to combat obesity and stay healthy. Well, gardening's like same kind of as that. And how many people have been a gardener ever before or had to help in a garden? Okay, so to a bunch of you. So there's like some real lifting work, some real moving, some real get your muscles flowing working in gardening. Environmental stewardship, and particularly in spaces that don't have as much green, and bringing that exposure to green, that opportunity for habitat. We have bees at the Growing Hope Center, our urban farm. Our beehives, the last two seasons that we've had them, have died, which is really sad, and that's happening to a lot of bees. Have anyone heard about bees in the news? Like, the bees in the world are dying? So the bees in the world are dying, people don't really know why, and it's really probably because of pesticides in our environment, but that's like a really, really big deal. It's not just like, oh, no more cute little bees, not much more honey. Bees actually pollinate, I should look up these statistics before I rattle them off again. Bees pollinate something like half of all of our, like, all of our food crops. So without bees, there's no apples. Without bees, there's no almonds. Without bees, there's, and the list goes on and on and on and on. A whole lot of our fruit, quite a few of our vegetables, some of our other kind of crops are bee pollinated. So the fact that bees are dying in a really big way is a big deal. So in urban areas, particularly, people are really getting into beekeeping because that's important to pollinate to people that have crops grow food in urban areas, but also just to keep our bee populations around and growing. So our bees actually died last fall. One day we came and like we have two hives and our bees were like suddenly it was piles of hundreds and hundreds of dead bees. And that's happening everywhere and we don't really know why. We don't like it wasn't like a slow die off, it was just like one day there's no bees. I mean they were there, but they were just all dead. So crazy stuff. So one of the things that urban farms and urban gardens are doing are really bringing bees back. In Detroit, there's a really great urban beekeeping movement called Sweet on Detroit? I think Sweet on Detroit is something like that. I made them buttons once. Anyway, so some of the environmental stewardship is essential both for agriculture as well as just for urban green space and the benefits there. Learning opportunities that I was talking about, people can really learn and cross lines of class and race and culture. Food access and food security and community building. Who can define food security? Anyone? Food security is about the ability of everyone in our community to access fresh, healthy, culturally appropriate, and affordable food. So, why might someone be able not be able to access food?
Money.
Money? Why else? Transportation. Why else?
It's not there.
It's not there, right? It just might be too far away. So, and when I said the piece about the culturally appropriate, maybe we're in a community where the type of food I know how to prepare for my family is not the kind of food available in that community, or the kind of food, say, that's maybe I'm looking for halal meats, and there's no halal meats there, and so we don't have another protein source for my family because the halal is appropriate to my cultural background. So it's very real that a lot of people in communities don't have access to healthy food. And in Ipsy specifically, we have a really great Ypsilanti food co-op, but that's a really relatively small grocer compared to the population of our community. And we have, how many of you do grocery shopping somewhere in this area? Where do you go?
Whole Foods and
Whole Foods, Ann Arbor Farmers Market. So those are that way, quite a ways. Meijer. Meijer is popular with the with college folks. Where else?
The co-op.
We have an Ipsy directly in our community. We have a Kroger kind of east on Michigan Avenue, like past Ford Road. So a couple miles east of Michigan Avenue. Not the greatest Kroger, not the greatest quality, not the greatest safety, not the greatest cleanliness. That's the one nearest my house that we lovingly refer to as the ghetto Kroger. And then there's another Kroger that's just across Whitaker Road, across the highway, where there is no pedestrian pass or bike lane, which is actually going to finally be changing in the next 2 or 3 years, which is really, really, really exciting. And there used to be bus service from downtown Ipsy across there, and that is one of the bus lines that got cut. So if you're someone who relies on the bus, and also the bus, the number 10 bus, which is the one that goes to that East Michigan Avenue, I don't think it runs on Sundays at all. So if Sunday is the day you have off, say, of work, and that's the day you can get there, and you have to go across that whole parking lot from having no sidewalk there, and pedestrians actually have died in that stretch of Michigan Avenue because there's not lighting, there's not sidewalk, there's not snow clearance in the winter, et cetera, et cetera. Getting to food, even though it may only be a mile that way or a mile that way, could be a really, really big barrier. So not having a major grocery store, but not having other outlets. Luckily, in Ipsy, we have some other outlets now, but they're probably not enough to serve our whole broader community. So we have Dos Hermanos in downtown Ipsy, which came in some ways as a result of a healthy food access project a lot of us in the community did. So that's a great Mexican grocery. They have a deli. And if anyone like tacos and eat pork, so hot tip. So on Fridays and Saturdays, they have a taco bar that you can go in, and for $1.50, you can have like the best taco ever. The butcher comes out, this is worth telling you. The butcher comes out and like cuts you can do pork or beef or tongue, and like makes, and there's little corn tortillas, and they're super, super simple, and they're $1.50, and it's like the best cheap, fresh food ever. So anyway, Fridays and Saturdays, Dos Hermanos. Right in downtown Ipsy, we have Ypsilanti Food Co-op, but we don't have a lot of other options. And so in work that we've done with a lot of people in the community and really surveyed and interviewed, there's a lot of people who say, you know, I spend a lot of time. I wait till I can get my daughter's car every other week, and then we can go out to here, and then we can take the bus here on these days to get dry goods or get a toilet paper from Walmart. And we learned that people were, one, not feeling like they had good access, and two, spending a lot of time and energy that they probably didn't have, and probably money as well in transportation and gas and bus fare to get to food that they felt was appropriate quality and at a decent price that was affordable. So one of the things that Growing Hope is working to do, among other partners, is trying to make healthy, affordable options. And some people say, well, that should be about bringing in a major grocery store. But we have major grocery stores sort of in the vicinity, even though they're not accessible. So turning to some of these other options, like farmers markets, like smaller stores, like mobile vending, like mobile groceries, and things like community gardens and home gardens are a key way for people to increase their own food security. And that's kind of the work we're most couched in, is this stuff about food access and food security. Then we get into community building and all that. Good. So this is a definition of a food desert. Now, this is a term you'll see. It's becoming kind of unpopular, but it's about residents lacking convenient access to supermarkets or other food outlets to provide healthy food options. Food deserts are, by research, linked to higher prevalence of chronic health issues and related death, particularly obesity, type 2 diabetes, and related things. But you know, people talk about Detroit a lot as a food desert, and that's been in national news, as well as locally talked a lot about, because Detroit doesn't have a major chain grocery store. But Detroit does have actually some smaller, decent-sized grocery stores and a lot of smaller, like, bodega-y market-sized things. Detroit's a big place, though, so there are plenty of neighborhoods where party stores, convenience stores, gas stations are the main and only place to access food. So there are still many food access issues in Detroit, but some people feel like calling something a food desert because it doesn't have a big chain, it doesn't have a Meijer in the city, is kind of saying that like the only thing that would work is if we have this big giant mega store, and that these smaller stores are not, which are often locally owned, are not sort of valid options. And building up those smaller stores, I think particularly here in the Ypsilanti community, is what our main option is, and is going to best serve people in our community as well as keep dollars local. So here's some statistics that sort of drive some of the work that we and partners do. If we look at overweight and at risk for obese adults in Washtenaw County, we look between 2005 2010, the trend is not good. See, do you see that? This is from a survey the Department of Public Health does every 5 years. 10% jump in 5 years is like really, really bad. And this is countywide. So we live, if you're new, we live in Washtenaw County. And this is countywide. And if you look at from a healthcare cost, it's crazy. So prevalence of obesity, that's 2008, then projection for 2013, and projection for 2018, if we stay on the current trajectory. So moving from 26 to 44% of people in Washtenaw County on this trajectory will be obese. So almost one in two people will be battling obesity in 2018. That's really bad on a lot of levels. But if you look at the potential healthcare cost of that, of just that condition, that's crazy, crazy big numbers that are very real. If you're a major employer, a university, a government, a public health provider, someone who's providing Medicare or Medicaid, there's a lot of cost and a lot of harm to people associated with that. And healthy food is one of those things. So we look at actually then groceries and restaurants and the trend since the 50s on. You know, the idea here is, look, there used to be about the same. There were groceries probably smaller in scale, not nearly as many, you know, here's the Mega Meijer, but more small neighborhood-based groceries, butchers, et cetera. And restaurants, we ate a lot more food at home. And I know me, when I grew up, I ate a lot less food out than I do now. That's very true with my lifestyle. I'm eating out several times a week, several meals, lunch every day at Beezy's is like a real, I don't even think twice about. But if we look at the that trend and the relation of restaurants to groceries, we're eating out more and more and more. And those numbers are so big because of fast food. And in low-income areas, there's lots of fast food. There's lots of fast food in lots of areas. But in low-income areas, there's lots of fast food and a lot less healthy options sort of alongside that fast food, which are cheap, fast, and sometimes delicious, sometimes disgusting, depending on how you look at it, calories. And that trend sort of illustrates it. And if we look, well, actually won't look that quite there. We can also look at another not-so-good trend of people eating their fruits and vegetables, which is a very important thing, and the trend is going in a downward direction. And that's not so good. And then we look at some disparities in our county. So these are percentages, so Washtenaw County overall, Ann Arbor, Ypsilanti, and then we look at some other different breakdowns. Makes under $35,000 a year, African-American, or no health insurance. One of the things I think is really interesting is that while the county average is 33% of county residents are overweight, 63% at that far end of people who have no health insurance are overweight in this county, according to this survey, and the health department has done, you know, appropriate kind of sampled survey for a number of years. We also look at some of the disparities. So if you that really get to what people have access to and probably what people can afford. Washtenaw County, 39%. Ann Arbor, 40%, about the same. Eat fast food once a week or more. Ypsilanti, 49%. We have a lot more. We have a lot other fewer options. We have a lower income population overall. People are eating more fast food, and that is directly linked to health status, obesity, diabetes. I learned on this program the other night, which was incredible, about how we design our communities and how that relates to obesity and how we're oriented towards cars. And here in Southeast Michigan, we're really oriented towards cars and driving, and that means we're also not exercising and staying fit as much. That the cost of diabetes in the United States annually, type 2 diabetes, so adult onset, what is generally caused by weight and diet, is equal to 2% of our gross national product. I don't really understand all those GNP kind of words, but like that one thing, diabetes annually is equal to that, and something like $250 billion is the cost of diabetes in our country annually. So we talk about like economic conditions and that kind of thing in our communities, our societies. This is a really very real part of it, and we are currently, your generation, I don't know if it counts for my generation, but your generation is the first generation, really, really tragically, where your life expectancy is less of that of your parents, and it's directly linked to that. So that's scary stuff, like no matter what, and it really is related to healthy food access. It's really related to eating healthy food, having those habits, learning to cook, preparing meals, and getting physical activity. I mean, it's kind of simple. Like, it's related to those two things, and there's sort of no qualms about that. Any questions before I go on from there? Are you following me? Questions? Comments? Okay. We also think about local economy. Anyone ever seen this kind of diagram about keeping dollars local? Sort of national statistics. If we think about locally owned business, so Walmart, for instance, is headquartered in Arkansas. So in Arkansas is where Walmart probably has things like their attorneys, their insurance companies, their finance people, their marketing people, their et cetera, et cetera. So many of those, their HR department, their all of those sort of things that support a company are there. So the Ypsilanti Food Co-op, or say Hiller's. Hiller's is a grocery store that's based in southeastern Michigan. So Hiller's has all of those same exact things in this community. So every time you spend a dollar at Hiller's, more of that dollar is staying in our local community because it's supporting the local attorney, the local marketing firm, the local graphic designer, the local HR person, the local accountant, the local et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, the local web designer, et cetera. Then if you spend your money at a place that is not headquartered here, a larger corporation that is somewhere else, more of that money is going away. And so we can, by supporting locally owned businesses, support more local jobs and have more of our dollars stay in our community. And more jobs is something we hear about, right, in Michigan that we all want more of. And that is the number one way. And so there's been studies that have shown exactly how we do that. So at a locally owned business, this is for $100 spent at a locally owned business and $100 spent at a non-local business. $73 at a locally owned business stay in the local economy. And let me try to oh gosh, they're so small. And they're so blurry on here. Okay, the kind of things that includes that stay in the local economy are wages, right, workers and folks here, local school police, et cetera. Okay, I'm just going to guess at what those things say. Local investments in your community, so having a local foundation where you're more likely to give local and support groups like mine and others. Money that's leaving the economy. Oh, shoot, what does it say? Oh, yeah, supplies. So you may be a grocery store, but that doesn't mean you're or you may be a hardware store, but that doesn't mean all your items that you're stocking are made here. So probably still about that much on average is still leaving because you're still supplying products or things like that are coming from throughout the country or the world. So in contrast, when you're a non-locally owned business, of your $100, $57 leave your local economy, and $43 stay in your local economy. So that red is what leaves. So what do you think stays in the local economy for a non-locally owned business? So what is Walmart spending money on, or Kroger, they're based in Ohio. What are they spending money on that is staying in this local economy? Yeah, they're building, right? They're building, and they are going to probably employ people to maintain that building who are here because they're probably not going to fly someone in every time they need to maintain. Probably most of their workers, if not all of their workers, in terms of immediate store management and immediate workers, et cetera, are going to be here. So they still are circulating wages. So people say, well, let's bring this company to town because it will supply jobs. Well, so that's true, and jobs are good. But if you can bring several smaller companies instead who are based in this area, you're really going to supply a lot more jobs and have a lot more money and support and growth in your local economy than you bring the big one person from out of town, like a Walmart, where studies have shown that you're actually, you can be hurting the local economy because you're often then displacing a whole lot of other locally owned businesses. So that just gives you kind of a little sense why we're all about buy local. And if we look at even in terms of food dollars, so in eastern Washtenaw County, so east of Arborland, basically, let's say, in 2010, we spent $346 million on food. I don't know. That just seems like a lot in my book. I can't really imagine what $346 million is. And the USDA estimates per capita food expenditures at $4,000. So on average, we each spent $4,000 on food. And again, much of that money that we're going to eat no matter what is flowing out of our community. So when we spend money on local food or locally produced products and or at local stores, those dollars, which are we're going to spend no matter what, are going to stay in our community and help create more jobs, sustain the economy, give our cities and communities tax revenue, et cetera. In the city of Ypsilanti alone, how many residents do we have? We have just under 20,000 residents as of the 2010 census. And so just under 20,000 folks, and that includes many of you EMU folks who are living on campus or in the city, spend $4 million on fruits and vegetables in a year. I don't know. That still seems like a whole lot of money. So I'm like, oh, hey, my little garden business or my urban farm or my farm on the periphery of this region, $4 million is a lot of spending power. So maybe in a down economy, we're not going to spend as much on fancy this or fancy that, but we're still going to buy food, right? Who's going to still buy food no matter, or try to get food whatever way they can? Average of $453 per household. And I know a whole lot of households who spend $453 just in a few months on fruits and vegetables, at least in my world. So we know that people want healthy local food. So in 2006, our total spending at our downtown Ypsilanti Farmers Market was $22,000. So people were spending $22,000 in downtown. And this past, in 2011, it was $108,000, and it's, I think, over $110,000 in 108 in 2011. Maybe that was 2010. Yeah, I think maybe that's about right. So near $110,000. That's a lot of money being spent in our downtown community to people just setting up a little tent once a week in 6 months of the year. So this is one day a week, 4 hours, 6 months of the year, people are spending $108,000 in local food, and those sales have just grown and grown and grown. This number is really increased this year, which we're really excited about. 30%, about 29% of all the market sales are people using food stamps and other form of public assistance at our market. So people have perceptions that people with not a lot of money don't want to eat good food, don't know how to eat food, good healthy food, etc. Well, that's a load of nothing. And people, when they have access to fresh, healthy, affordable food, they use the resources they have, and whether that's food stamps or WIC or some of these other food assistance programs, and they buy it. And we've seen it and we've shown it. So we were really excited that we were the third market in Michigan to accept food stamps. And last year, over 80 markets across our state accepted food stamps. So farmers market accepting food stamps is a big trend in Michigan. Michigan is one of the leading states. I'm sure this year over 100 markets will, and we all around the state support each other. So that's some very real dollars. So back a little to Growing Hope. Are we still following, or are we doing okay here? So our values sort of inform what we do, and I've kind of alluded to a number of our values. So we work to build capacity. So people say teach a man to fish, so we teach a woman to fish, or we teach a woman to grow a tomato, and she'll feed her family for the lifetime. She'll probably share with her neighbors. Maybe she'll can and freeze that for an extended season, and maybe she'll start her own salsa business and become a vendor at our market just from learning to grow tomatoes. I'm really excited that we work with low and no income families and help them get vegetable gardens, raised bed vegetable gardens growing in their yards. We've worked with 150 families in the last 3 years, and one of our families from last year in the Willow Run neighborhood got so excited by their 3 4x4 foot beds that they are now in our garden leadership training course, and they're starting a whole community garden in their neighborhood as a way for more people in the community to learn and benefit from what they learned and benefited being first-time gardeners last year, which is really, to us, is about building capacity. So we help provide first-year kind of support, and now they're taking the leadership and are building capacity in their whole neighborhood, really. Empowerment, it's about building on people's assets and strengths and not on their deficits. So it's very common that we talk about people being disadvantaged, under-resourced, at risk, and all these really negative words that don't empower anyone. So when we can start from the recognition that every single person in our communities has something to offer, everyone has assets, everyone has strengths, everyone has abilities, everyone has knowledge, everyone has life experience, and we build from that, we build something in a much more powerful and proactive way. We believe in maximizing partnerships and playing well with others, so we work with a lot of other entities. And sustainability to us is about environment, but it's also about how do we keep this economy in the city of Ypsilanti going and not folding like so many Ypsilanti and Michigan economies are on the brink of doing, and how do we keep jobs here, and how do we build new businesses and support entrepreneurs and all of those things. So sustainability to us is about that as well. And it's about equity. How can people have access to resources? How can people have access to jobs? How can people have access to transportation and those sort of things? Here's kind of our main stuff. We're trying to get more healthy food to access, particularly our home community. We're helping to make people excited and happy about healthy food, particularly kids, knowing that it's cool to grow food and it's cool to eat healthy food. Helping people just grow their own, and whether that's realizing that they just need access to our tool library of shovels and a wheelbarrow once a year, or a rototiller, or seedlings or things like that. Community vitality and cultivating leadership, helping develop garden leaders and thinking about how to connect food and growing and gardening with our economy. And there's some pretty pictures while I drink some water. And people say, well, what do you do in the winter? Well, we do a lot all the time. So there's a little graph of when we do what. And I'll go into a few of these. So because what we're doing often is being kind of that resource, that trainer. Often what we're doing is not we do plenty during like spring and summer and kind of prime gardening season. But we're running a Monday night leadership training course right now for 6 weeks. We're about to start our seed starting squad, where we're helping people in the community get seedlings growing for us, and that's ramping up right now. We run an after school program that goes on through the fall and the winter. We have a hoop house that we're harvesting from 11 to 12 months of the year. Our farmer's market goes through October, and then November and December, there's an indoor market at the Corner Brewery, which is really nice beer and vegetables, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we're doing outreach and policy and advocacy work. Right now, one of the things that was mentioned in my bio is that I serve on the Michigan Food Policy Council. So the chair is of the council is the director of the Department of Agriculture for the state. And we have several kind of higher-ups from other state departments. And we're trying to figure out how, from a policy and a legislative perspective, we can do things like support local farms, but like support new things like food processing as a economic opportunity for the state, how we can support gardens and farmers markets, healthy food access. So I chair this new food access task force. So our job is to figure out how 80% of Michigan residents can, by 2020, have good access to food, 20% of which will be from Michigan. And that's one of the tenets of the Michigan Good Food Charter. So if you're interested in food stuff, go to michiganfood.org and read our Good Food Charter. We have a really great statewide kind of framework document that a lot of people work several years to develop. And so we have this, you know, little task of like 80% of people in this whole state develop like having access to healthy food by 2020. So we don't have a lot of time. And so what we are trying to figure out on this task force is how do we even measure that? Like, what would be those indicators of knowing that we have healthy food? So we're trying to think, well, are there food banks and emergency food pantries, and is there healthy food available at those? And then some of it from Michigan. Are there farmers markets available in communities? Are there grocery stores? Are there new retail establishments? What are all of these sort of things? So we're trying to literally figure out, okay, what in the world kind of baseline data can we figure out from the whole state, and can we continue to track and measure to know that people have access to healthy food? I mentioned our garden leadership training, which is about community organizing, really. Our seed starting squad, this is a really fun kind of example. So that's sitting outside in the snow, which is not where it would stay. That was just to take a picture. We need a lot of seedlings because we give them away, we sell them, we plant them at our own urban farm. And we didn't really have a way to grow them. Who's ever grown seedlings before? So you need some lights, right? You kind of need a warm space. It's an inside activity in our climate, et cetera. We didn't have a way to grow as many as we need. So we also realized that there was nothing in the marketplace that was an affordable thing to help you get growing. So we designed something. We built it with volunteers. So this is our light stand. Those are 2 4-foot chop lamps, really readily available. We build this for $45 to $50. Has four lamps. Four bulbs, excuse me, and there's room for four flats underneath. You know what a flat is? A flat of plants? Like it holds 48 little cell trays of that. So there's room for four underneath. So anyone can sign up, whether you have any experience or no experience or super experience, for our seed starting squad. You can apply, and you come and you get to come out to our hoop house in February or March or April kind of time when it's getting really nice and warm in there, even though it's super cold outside. And you learn a little bit about planting seedlings, about proper kind of care for growing your own seedlings, and you get to help plant up 2 seedlings trays that you take home for yourself, and then you basically have 2 space for 2 more seedlings for yourself. So those 2 trays you grow for us. We provide those seeds and trays and plants and soil and such. And last year, 80 households grew over 6,000 seedlings for us, and probably about that for much for themselves. You could either buy this from us, which helps us support the cost of the program, or you can borrow it so it's so totally affordable. So this is for us a really good illustration of our belief in figuring out win-win-win. There was not an affordable product in the marketplace. A lot of people, anyone ever have trouble growing seedlings at home? Anyone ever try that? And yeah, I can raise my hand, and I'm pretty experienced. You know, it's not perfect, and you have to kind of have the right conditions, and you do have to sort of know something, and anyone can try it, but we realized that was a barrier for people growing their own food. It was like, oh, I really want to do it. I know I can do it more affordably if I get these seedlings going first, but I don't really know how. I don't have the setup. Those setups cost a lot of money. Do I have the right kind of window if I don't have lights, et cetera, et cetera. So by helping to overcome that barrier, which is a lot of what we're trying to do, to getting people growing, help overcome our barrier of not having a way of growing growing enough stuff, and introducing an affordable product really in the marketplace, win, 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 win. So 6,000 seedlings was really great for us. People had the experience, they learned, they had kind of a workshop from us, and they were able to grow for themselves in a really affordable way. So it's those kind of things. You know, you just sort of like, you hit on them at times. And it's pretty fun to come out to our hoop house. That was probably a little more like April kind of time. and get your hands in the soil. So then we get to the 4x4 foot beds. So we like to grow things in 4x4 units. So this table series is probably just over 4x4 feet. Okay, so imagine this space. How much could you grow in here? Anyone know? Anyone describe? A lot. Anyone ever grown in a space about this sort of size or scale or shape? So one good point is that we don't really know. So I can tell you, because I know, because I'm a gardener and teach these things, is that you can grow a lot in a very small space. But when we're thinking in our community about how do we solve healthy food access issues, or people being hungry, or obesity, and we know people need to eat more and have more closer affordable access to healthy food, when I say this is the thing, and we can't say, well, how much is that, and how much will they grow, and how would that really affect things, et cetera, we started with this sort of unit, and so we use this as a base unit of measure. So throughout a lot of what we're doing at our urban farm and working with families, so the families I mentioned that we work with to help them install raised bed gardens, they, in exchange for that thing that's helping them overcome barriers, help us overcome this barrier by they weigh and they track what they grow. So we're building a very real-world data set, because there's like figures out there of how much corn can you grow on an acre, right? But you can't divide that down to 4x4 feet. It just doesn't kind of work quite that way. And there's some figures out there, that square foot gardening book and some things that say, well, this is this sort of ideal level. But is that what a real person can really do? And maybe they don't have exactly the sun they need. Maybe they don't have exactly the conditions. Maybe they're not very experienced. And how much could someone really realistically grow? So we're building that data set, which is really exciting. And so we use these 4x4 foot beds as this kind of base unit. Because we could also say, hey, can you just kind of, maybe gardening in your memory is something the size of this room that was your grandmother's kind of back 40, right? That you had to weed when you were a kid in the summers. Anyone have that kind of memory? I don't think I could grow because a garden must be this big kind of crazy thing. Well, if I can just sort of contain something, just a little 4x4 foot bed, do you have room in a front yard for this? A side yard? You just have this much space? And then we can help to tell you how much you can grow. Let me tell you, in our hoop house, so in our greenhouse, which is heated only by the sun, one of our 4x4 foot beds, a couple of years ago, the most productive run, grew 57 pounds of heirloom organic tomatoes, which had a retail value, and that was just in about 5 months of the year, because it had other crops in it, other types of the year. 57 pounds, that was worth about $350. One 4x4 foot bed grew about $350 of food. So that's a lot, I think, by anyone's by anyone's measure. That's a lot for that little space. So now we think about, well, what could we grow? How much salad can we grow in that? And how many times with salad, which is something you can cut and harvest and grow over and over and over, or something like collards or kale that you could grow really and harvest almost the entire year with very little effort. How much can that supplement my family's, stretched food budget? How much can that bring the healthy food close to home? One of our families, who is definitely the off-the-charts family, but the first year we worked with the raised bed families, they, in their 3 4x4 foot beds, so 3 the size of this, grew 115 pounds of food in just about five, six months of the year. And we actually calculated the value of that. That was worth about $188. $188 of food, I don't know. My food budget is a lot. Anyone that feels like a significant amount? That was just 3 4x4 foot beds. And they were definitely they were the overachievers, but it kind of gives you a sense of what's possible. So we're measuring and weighing and tracking both everything that we harvest at our urban farm, which is not what this is, but this is at Town Center, a low-income senior high-rise right downtown Ipsy, where they have a community garden and are all growing in 4x4 foot beds. We also sell 4x4 foot raised bed kits. So you see people all around the town with 4x4 beds. We make them really affordably. We sell them really affordably. You could buy them for like hundreds of dollars from garden catalogs, and we sell them for $35. And we tell you how you can make it, and you can make it for definitely less than that if you're interested. So it's about bringing kind of growing and helping people grow down to this least common denominator, kind of down to this really simple unit that's about the size of that table. There's people on the seed starting squad. It looks kind of warmish in there. That's probably February or March, which is really nice. So one of our families, our raised bed families, we do make some of the beds more accessible, and so that someone in a wheelchair, other families and volunteers, building things, building raised bed kits. And then we do a lot with kids. So we are really helping kids eat healthy foods and be familiar with healthy foods, middle schoolers particularly. We take them on field trips to the farmer's market. We run an after-school program. This is the kind of thing you could come and be a volunteer with. You could volunteer for any of the things I'm talking about, really. We do this all pretty much with volunteers. And we also do internships and things like that. So our students come to the farmers market, they go to the Growing Hope Center, they plant things, and we're working with them after school once a week throughout the year, and they're cooking every day after school. So middle schoolers are eating, you wouldn't believe, middle schoolers, many of whom have very little experience with even knowing what certain fresh fruits and vegetables are, smoothies with fresh kale and spinach in them, which, right, so you made that face. I would probably make that face too, even though I like it. You know, I'm like, don't mess up my smoothie. You put the key, blueberries, so then they don't see the green color unless they think that's cool. Kind of covers up the, but you wouldn't actually even know, and you're suddenly getting a bunch of fresh food. We have kids, we make homemade pizza with whole wheat dough from that we make from scratch with the kids, and we've had parents say, my kid came home and said we had to go get all those ingredients and make that from scratch. In a household where they probably don't cook a lot from scratch. So we've had parents come out and be with us on our farm in our summer version of our program, and kids are cooking, they're harvesting from the garden things that they grew. They're washing it and cutting it and making it right there in a big stir fry of like all vegetables with brown rice, like super healthy thing. And the parents are like, oh, my kid doesn't eat that. And the kid's like, uh-huh, yeah, I eat it. Because when someone grows it, kid or adult, when you grow it yourself, you taste it, and generally you love it. And that's how we change behavior, and that's how we change the generation where our kids have a lower life expectancy than ourselves, is by getting those lessons and values in from a young age and helping them filter up through the parents as well. So there's kids with, I mean, look, kids cooking healthy food. We also employ a number of teens and from the broader Ipsy area. Naya now just graduated from high school, is in WCC's culinary program. We're so proud of her. And Kelsey is on graduating high school this year, heading to college, and I think is going to study sustainable agriculture. So we employ these teens who've come up through our younger youth programs, and then they act as peer educators to the younger youth. So younger youth, when they learn from these teens, also are going to be a lot more receptive. And we run a summer camp in West Willow neighborhood that goes along with their community garden, which we're a partner in. And so it's a drop-in camp and lots of fun pictures of cute kids. Again, kids eating healthy food. Actually, you see what he's eating? So that's a lettuce wrap. Made with like collards from the garden and then with other chopped up vegetables. The kids helped make this with stuff that they harvested right there from their community garden. And like, you know, you think you could generally give a kid like a collard green with vegetables chopped inside and be like, yeah, eat this raw collard with vegetables. Probably not. But those kids all eat it up because they have the pride that they know where their food came from. It's a really powerful thing. And then our farmer's market, which we are really proud of, we have up to 60 vendors. This year we had over 15,000 customers. Half of all of our customers make less than $25,000. We have a huge diversity of customers, huge diversity of vendors. Many of our vendors are also low income, huge diversity in terms of sort of class as well. A lot of seniors who come from the neighboring public subsidized housing. So a lot of wheelchairs and walkers in our market. And if you want to like feel what there is to love about Ipsy, go to the farmer's market, go to our market. I mean, I don't know. You have any reflection on that? I just get so happy whenever I walk in.
I mean, we decided to live in the city of Ypsilanti because partly of what all of this is reflecting about our community, and you know, just the involvement in what happens around here.
Yay. Pictures of our market. One of the things that's unique about our market too is that we really make space. We really consciously make space for vendors of all scales. So we have vendors who come from literally across the street and around the corner and bring their stuff to market in a wagon who are at a garden scale. And right now we're working on the development, we're just facilitating of a Ypsilanti growers cooperative. They're getting all up and going. So this is people who are garden scale people in the Ipsy community who want to sell stuff at market, but they don't have enough to have a whole booth. That's not worth the time, that's not worth the investment, et cetera. But when you pull it together and they only need to take a shift here and there and can kind of jointly market, then it makes it really worth it. And there's some models in Detroit and in Flint that we've been working off of. And now we have a great group of community members who are going to be a joint vendor at the market. So, and we've had other people who've shared booths and grown together and started to try out their product. Zeal, who's part of the growers co-op and was on our board, she's been making like soy milk stuff. She's Taiwanese and has been making like soy granola stuff. It's really delicious. And making her own fresh soy milk, which is actually, I don't like soy milk, and it's actually really good. So I may be like kind of a crunchy-ish person, but I don't necessarily, you know, like all those things. If we look at a sales by payment type, this is 2010, so 2011 I mentioned that more like 29% of our sales are using food stamps and some other programs. And if you look at EBT, bridge card, food stamps, all the same thing, and you look at those sales, if you look at 2011, the sales are more like $15,000. So that's a jump from 6 to 9, and then this past year we don't have that graph in yet, a jump to 15. So again, people want healthy food. People use the dollars they have in whatever kind of way that is, food stamps or otherwise, to buy it, and it's a win. I mean, that we have over 800 people, I think we were over 900 for the first time this summer, coming into downtown Ipsy in a 4-hour block on a Tuesday afternoon. That's a lot of people. And when we think about downtown vitality and like how do we get people to revitalize a downtown, we often think of things like special events, right? Like, let's have a festival or a big fair or a big party or whatever. Well, so what I try to tell the city is like, look, I'm running a special event once a week, 6 months of the year at no cost to you. Right, 800 people, that's getting people downtown, that's making it feel safer and more vibrant and attracting great other people to buy and live in the community. So we feel like the market is about the food and healthy food, but it's so much about community and so much about economy as well. Kids working, we have hundreds and hundreds of volunteers every year. So I encourage you all to come out and volunteer because we need your help. We have daytime, we have evening, we have weekend opportunities, and we have opportunities in all sorts of things. We also have things like community potlucks. And then I'll just tell you, because I like this picture. So who's that? Jenny G, I like to call her. That's my little pet name for her. And that's me. And this is her at our place in Ipsy signing a bill into law. So I'm really proud of what happened here in 2010. That's Rebecca Warren there. She's our state senator on the second from right. That's a state representative from like Ferndale, and that's Pam Burns, who used to be our state representative in the west part of Washtenaw County. I've been getting more and more involved in policy, and we helped advocate and testify at the state legislature for a bill that right here got signed into law called the Cottage Food Law. Anyone ever heard of it? Besides that group over there. So one thing we realized from our farmers market, I mentioned in the beginning the commercial kitchen, is that we have a real limiting factor, that particularly people with lack of access to transportation or a lot of money who are trying to start their food-based business don't have a way to get to one of those commercial kitchens. Or maybe you can use a church kitchen for some things, but not for others. But just that kitchen space, and you don't have the money to like build a whole commercial certified kitchen, is a real limiting factor. And we found that very much from running a farmer's market, because people would call us wanting to be a vendor for great sounding products, and we have to, from a health department aspect, say, you know, do you cook or prepare in a certified kitchen? And they say no, and always, where is one? I can't find one, or I can't get to one in the hours, or I don't have a car, etc. So this law allows people to sell certain things at farmer's markets under a total sales volume of $15,000 without having to process them in a commercial kitchen. It's a very specific list of products. It's basically baked goods, jams and jellies, flavored vinegars, dried herbs. It's pretty much what it is. So it's things that are fairly food safe, but you can now basically kind of get started with your business out of your home kitchen. You label and package things in certain ways according to the law without having to find a kitchen. So hopefully you can then, once you've gotten to that level of sales, maybe you have some more income or resources to sort of step up that production. And so we saw an immediate, that was July 2010, and we saw an immediate difference in our market. And this year we had maybe 5 new businesses that launched because of this law. And that's really a gratifying thing to see people like come up to me and be like, hey, because of this, I was able to quit my other job. Because of this, I was able to, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, I'm speeding on through. We have other things, like you guys have been on Tour de Fresh, a big bicycle and bus garden tour. And then here's our home place. So here's the Growing Hope Center before we started with it. This is in, when we bought it, our urban farm, I keep mentioning, on Michigan Avenue in 2007. And it looks very different from this now. And I don't actually have that many pictures of how it looks now. Here's where it is. I'm just going to hurry through this. This is kind of the vision, which is almost done. Oh, there's our hoop house. It's really pretty. It's really nice to be in there and breathe the moist air. That's got a lot of seedlings in the front, but then all stuff. It's 30 by 96 feet. My little hoop house, it's 12 by 16 feet in my backyard today, was like over 63 degrees. Like it was 63 degrees in late afternoon, so it was probably 65 to 70 in there earlier today. So this place can easily, this time of year, in like January, February, even if it's not like crazy warm outside, can get in the 60s and 70s with not a lot of trouble. And we're really, really growing year-round. doing a lot of different things on our site. There's it in the winter. And there's an example of a 4x4-foot bed with lettuce. So just sort of like look at that and imagine how much salad that is, how many people that could feed. And again, lettuce is something you could harvest over and over and over. If that's all you did, one 4x4-foot bed of lettuce or greens or something like that and fed your family, that can make a big difference. And seeds, how much does a packet of seeds cost? Dollar, 10 cents at Big Lots, $2, $3 for the super fancy ones, maybe. That's easily, you know, you can plant a 4x4-foot bed easily with a whole packet of seeds. We actually, at the Growing Hope Center, we have grown over a ton of food on just over a quarter acre, which is basically like less than two city lots. We're growing over a ton of food, and we're donating, we're selling. We are selling wholesale, retail, selling right at the farmer's market. We're using it throughout our organization. There's the hoop house in about February, so that's about what's growing now, is something like that. So a lot of spinach, crops like that. That's probably February or March. So you can grow stuff in Michigan all year round. People don't think you can. There's a few outside. That's Swiss chard in April when it goes like crazy in the hoop house. That's our hoop house in the summer. So those tomatoes I was telling you about, it's because we train them vertically. This hoop house is 15 feet tall in the peak. So we train them vertically, and they climb as far as they'll let you, and you can get a lot more stuff. So one of the things we'll also demonstrate is what can you do in a small space. Well, you can grow up. We built an adobe pizza oven by hand with our summer youth employment program, and we make really, really, excuse my language, kick-ass pizzas, which cook from 3 minutes. It gets like 600 to 800 degrees in there. Super, super fun. That structure will eventually have a green roof on it. We'll be powering some things by solar. We have a geothermal heating and cooling system, and I see my symbol. So that was my last slide anyway. And so that's a little about where we are. Ask questions while your last like minute on the thing is, and I'll keep telling and then I'll keep telling you a little bit more about where we are at the Growing Hope Center, because we're about to like fully open this facility.